Hi everybody, this is theCUBE's evening session at RSAC, Monday night, day one. This is Dave Vellante. John Furrier is also here. And we're here with Open Policy and the NYSE Wired and Anishin. And I'm really pleased to have Stephen Ellion here. He's the CFO of ADAMnetworks, a company focused on protecting critical infrastructure. Adam, good to see you.
Thank you for having me.
You bet. So tell us about ADAMnetworks. I got a little blurb from your website. You're focused on cybersecurity, secure DNS filtering, zero trust network access, internet policy enforcement, but sounds like a lot of mumbo jumbo, but you've cut through it. What do you guys actually do?
So ADAMnetworks is the first and only default denial solution at scale. So imagine protecting your home. Current solutions focus on threat detection, meaning all sorts of actors can come into your home, and if they're considered unknown, they're not yet a threat, we focus our computing power on finding the bad guy and kicking him out. We think that's a broken way of approaching cybersecurity. That's not how I protect my house. The way I protect my house is nobody comes into my house unless I have initiated the connection with a good and known source. So that's what our tool does. It's a software tool that can live anywhere between the device and the internet. It can live in the cloud, it can live on-prem. It does not have to be downloaded onto the endpoint agent, which makes it ideal for protecting OT and IoT. And it focuses its computing power on what is good and necessary for that device. And the administrator gets to decide, essentially, what the version of the internet is for each specific device under its administration. The implication of that is that we don't have to know about the next threat to protect against it, because that threat is not part of your version of the internet. I came to the company, I'm formerly from the financial services industry, and I was running a regulated financial services firm 7 years ago when we were starting to get phished. We were getting the inbound emails that looked very, very legitimate, but were not. And that was the beginning of my journey to understand that I'm one click away from opening a door to an adversary that once I find out they're in my house, so to speak, it's too late to do anything about it. And that was the beginning of my journey with ADAMnetworks.
Interesting. So on your website, I love this, there's real-time detection, which everybody talks about real-time detection. It's not fast enough. You've already been breached.
Yes.
And so you're flipping that philosophy of get the bad guys out of there fast and saying, don't let them in. Just don't give them access.
Correct. And we're saying, look, the internet is huge in terms of the number of domains, and it's growing by the day. It's too easy to spin up a malicious domain. It's too easy to circumvent DNS, which we use as the root of trust, and use direct IP connections to institute an attack. So the number science of threat detection is squarely against the industry. You cannot keep up with all the new threats that are coming about, and if you're throwing AI at it, guess what? So is the adversary. So as opposed to throwing more AI at a problem and playing whack-a-mole with the adversary, we basically say we will help our clients, and we do help our clients every day, win the cyber war by simply removing your assets from the battlefield. Why are we fighting the war on the same terms that the adversary is proposing to us? We say the new threats can proliferate, because they will, but it's simply not part of your good and known version of the internet.
Okay, so the philosophy sounds really sensible.
Yes.
So two things. One is, why isn't everybody doing this?
Okay.
And then the second is, how do you balance the need for businesses to move fast and have access?
Yes.
And have facile real-time access to data, and at the same time protect them?
That's a great question. So part of the reason, at least from our understanding and my interaction with the industry over the last 6 years, because again, I didn't come to this as a technologist. When I saw what the technology could do, then I was asking, I basically spent 4 years consulting with the company asking that same question. Is what we have really that unique? And if it is, why isn't everybody doing it? And I think there's a couple of reasons. Number one is the internet is a relatively new technology. It's hard for us because we think in terms of, you know, minutes and days, but the internet is only about 25 years old. And as the internet proliferated throughout our society, security was not first and foremost on our minds. At the point that we realize that we have connected virtually everything, to include in some cases our light bulbs, to the internet, we start to realize that we've also connected everything to adversaries all around the world. And it's very difficult to then do an inversion of that philosophy once you're already that connected. Because the cybersecurity industry also grew alongside that paradigm of we'll respond to the threats as they come about. But a big piece of that is just the growth of computing power. Our solution is based on a default deny all philosophy, which if you talk to virtually any cybersecurity professional, they're going to shrug their shoulders and say, well, yeah, that makes the most sense, but it's not practical, which gets to the second part of your question. And that's what our founder, CEO, David Redekop, spent 7 years making with the engineering team a practical solution. But part of this also was the computing power needed to get to a point to where I don't just go in and add a new URL to my whitelist statically. I can't use the internet that way.
Right.
And so with the advent of AI, AI is an important component. If people choose to use it with ADAMnetworks, it is an important component as people constantly are forced to balance security with convenience. There is no solution that is 100% secure. The only secure way to interact with the internet is to just not connect to the internet. So if you're going to connect to the internet, you have to make that decision. I can put on the same ADAM node, I can put an IoT device on a static whitelist. Its version of the internet is only what I put on that whitelist. But also on the same ADAM node, I can infuse the decision-making engine with artificial intelligence to make that yes-no decision on the fly so that I can use my cell phone. I run all of my devices, we do on ADAMnetworks. We have a very seamless experience. So it's really just about how the administrator rolls out the technology in their environment. The way that our CEO talks about it when we do a deployment is that you're doing open heart surgery without killing the patient. So people can move as fast as they want to, but we encourage them to take it piece by piece so that you start with segments of your network that are the most critical, that are most vulnerable, and you tighten the ratchet down with default deny all until everything works and you move on to the next. But it's really the advent of AI to make those decisions at the gateway, at the network edge, that has allowed a default deny all posture that was not technologically feasible a decade ago, it now is.
So when did you guys start the company?
The company was founded in London, Ontario by our CEO and founder, David Redekop.
And when?
In 2013.
Okay, so you've been around a while.
Yes.
But you're now just funding the company or doing another sort of escalation,
yes,
right, of the firm, right? I mean, so you know, it's funny. One of our good clients, UiPath, mm-hmm, was founded like, I don't know, a decade ago, and then I think they actually did their first raise like 10 years after they've been around,
yeah,
and then they had a rocket ship.
Yeah.
They rode the company up to $38 billion valuation. It's not quite there today, but it was a fun ride.
Yeah.
But was that something similar here? You guys had sort of a nice business and then decided, wow, we've built something, now we can scale it?
It was the first 7 years of the company, which I was not a part of, was the core engineering team just building the product, which included building our own DNS caching resolver, which that didn't mean something to me when I joined the company, but now I know what that means,
yeah,
and that's kind of a big deal. So it was 7 years in product development to get something to work that everyone told our founder, you'd never get that to work. And then we started doing small commercial rollouts with small, medium-sized enterprises, and then so we have revenue. We have about 2 million devices that are presently behind an ADAMnetworks node. And then now in 2024 is when we began really our first proper seed raise. And we're about, yeah.
No, please, go ahead. Finish it.
Yeah, and we're about 4 million into a target 6 million seed raise that we're presently doing. And all of that raise is go to market. Product, not that you can't continue developing, but the product is matured, it's deployed, and so now it's all GTM.
It's all about scale. Those VCs must love that. Product's done. But the first 7 years, how were you so capital efficient?
That's a great question. It was 100% bootstrapped. So
that's amazing.
Yes.
And so it was client funded, perhaps, or
it was personal funded by the founder and engineering team, and then as we started onboarding initial adopters, then that started to build a revenue base, but also really a testing pool, because you have this great thing that works in the lab. It was deployed in people's homes on a select basis, but then you're working out all of the kinks that happen when you're actually deploying it live in a client environment.
I mean, it's non-traditional. I mean, that's, you got to be a serious believer. Of course, you got your founder who has patient capital.
Yes.
Because what's the founder's name?
David Redekop.
David Redekop. So it's a he. He obviously had a vision.
Yes.
And a conviction.
Yes.
Okay, so that's cool. Let me ask you this. So I was meeting with Nikesh Arora, the CEO of Palo Alto, last month. Yeah, it was in March. And he declared the end of best of breed. Meaning all these shiny point tools, we're the platform, eventually the world's going to consolidate. I'm overstating it.
Sure.
But in the fullness of time, consolidation is going to be the play. He declared the end of best of breed. You guys are clearly best of breed. How do you think about this business? Clearly, there's a proliferation of tools. We all know that. Everybody talks about how it's a problem. How do you think about that in terms of the roadmap for your company going forward?
It's a great question. I mean, kind of answer that one of two ways, kind of macro and micro. On a macro standpoint, we definitely see there's a tremendous amount of room for consolidation. It's a very fragmented marketplace.
Yeah.
And we even see that whether it's talking with prospective clients or talking to investors. There's been a tremendous amount of market confusion because we're all using the same language, right? I use the term, that's why we tend to default to default deny all, because zero trust connectivity is kind of the same as saying all natural or organic. What does that really mean? What does that actually do? And so from a macro standpoint, we would definitely see that there's very high likelihood of consolidation. From a micro standpoint for us, we're focused on solving the next problem for the next client who wants it solved. So the challenge for us is educating people and really finding the people who have either sadly been hurt badly enough to where they recognize that their existing tool set is inadequate and they need something else, or they're open to a new way of thinking about cybersecurity. So those are our clients and prospects now, and unfortunately, the network of cyber criminals is our best marketing force, because it continually shows that simply detecting the threat in the way that it's been done, regardless of how much AI is thrown at it, is not sufficient.
What's with the name? I thought you were going to say the founder's name was some dude named Adam.
No, the name, which I didn't have any part of naming, it really kind of evokes the idea of the Garden of Eden. It's the idea where we want to spend our time and energy not focused on the bad, but we want to allow people to simply focus and track the good, which is what our platform is based on.
That's awesome. Well, Stephen, thank you very much. Congratulations on getting here, and good luck with the raise.
Thank you so much.
Glad to have you back and monitor the progress. Appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
All right, and thank you for watching. This is Dave Vellante for John Furrier and the whole CUBE team. The CUBE at RSAC 2025. This is day one with open policy and New York Stock Exchange Wired, NYSE Wired. Right back, right after this short break.